way.
Thank you.
Good morning, Radiant Church. Let's stand up together this morning. Happy Sunday. Thank you for joining us for worship today. It's good to be in the house of the Lord with you. Let's pray together this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you just for another day to gather in your name with your people in this place, just to exalt you for who you are, for all that you've done in our lives. God, you're so worthy of our praise. So today we just set aside this time, Lord, to seek your face. We invite your presence here this morning, Lord. We love you. We honor you with our worship this morning. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's worship.
have torn apart the sea. You have led me through the deep. Hallelujah.
King David writes in Psalm 40, verse 16, he says, "But may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who long for your saving help always say, 'The Lord is great.'" This last week, I've been fighting a nasty flu bug, which is why I'm not singing this morning. I'm starting a nasty coughing fit for you all, which would not be nice. But this week, I was just flat on my back, and it was a Lord, I need you kind of week. Anybody else have one of those weeks this week? Yeah. So we're going to close our set this morning with a song called Same God. And I'm thankful that we serve a God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That his promises are faithful and true, and that when we call out to him, that he will answer, he will respond in love to us, and that we can trust him in all things. So let's worship him for that this morning.
Providing then, you are providing now.
touch right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. Never changing, oh, forever. You're the same God. You're the same.
God, we thank you so much that we do have your faithfulness to stand on in our lives. God, everything around us is shifting sand, but you are the firm foundation on which we can build our lives and put our hope, our faith, and our trust in you. So this morning, Lord, we just pray that our worship has ministered to your heart today, God. We just invite you to continue to meet with us throughout the rest of this service. Be with Pastor Barry as he brings the word this morning, we pray. And it's in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. All right, at this time, we're going to release our kids to their classes. Everybody else, go ahead and give the person next to you a fist bump.
Good morning, Radiant family. How y'all doing today? Some of you have broken out the spring swag, and I just have to say, you look good. And I'm so glad we can wear white and it'd be appropriate. So anyway, for those of you who are here for the first time, I want to be sure to say welcome. We are so glad you are here. My name is Kinsey, and I wanted to encourage you to fill out a connection card that I forgot to bring up with me because I was too excited and I forgot. But we have connection cards that are located in the seats in front of you, and there are two ways you can fill it out. One way is there's a QR code that you can scan and fill out our form electronically, where it basically just lets us know who you are, that you are here, and if you have any prayer needs, and our staff will be sure to pray for you this week. Or you can flip it over, fill it out manually, and you can drop it off at our guest services station located in our common area after the service. Now, I do have one announcement I want to be sure to highlight, and that is our Pack a Snack Drive. That's ending today, but it's not too late. If you haven't done it and you'd like to participate, just run to Meijer or Wally World right after service, come back, and you can drop off that snack in our Connections Room, which is located, if you're going out this way, directly to the left. These snacks are benefiting our Bangor Township area kiddos. And I just want to encourage you to participate, because even though it might seem small, when little is much, God is in it. And Jesus promises us that when we give to the least of these, we do so unto him. And he loves children. And it blesses his heart when we minister to the least of these who are children. And those snacks are going to be dropped off this week to our connection at the Bangor Schools. So for those of you who have participated already, thank you so much for your generosity. And now, as we move into a time of giving and continue to worship in that way, there are four ways you can give. And the first way is at our giving station located directly in the back, or you can snail mail a check to the P.O. Box address listed on the screen, or you can give online at radiantbc.com, or text any dollar amount to 84321 and follow the prompts from there. All right, we're going to pray now, if you can join me. Father God, I just want to thank you for this beautiful day you've given us. And I thank you for all the opportunities you provide for us in our everyday life to minister to others. And I pray, God, as these snacks go out, that it's more than just something to fill a little tiny person's belly. I pray that they can feel the love of Jesus with every snack they open. And I also ask, God, that you touch my friend Barry and that you anoint him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet, and that the words that come from him are are not his words, but your words. And I pray, God, for the miracle of salvation today in our auditorium today and also in our kids' classes. In your name, amen.
Good morning, Radiant Church. Here is your weekly update. From January through March, Radiant Church is teaming up with Causely and Souls for Souls. Every Facebook check-in or review with the hashtag GiveShoesGiveLove will help provide shoes to a child in need. You can learn more about this month's cause at soulsforsouls.org. Come and celebrate our resurrected King during Easter weekend here at Radiant. We'll be starting off with two Good Friday services at 4 and 5:30 p.m. on Friday, March 29th. Next, on Saturday, March 30th, we will be hosting our first ever Easter immersion experience for the whole family from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. And finally, we will be hosting three morning services on Sunday, March 31st at 8:30, 10, and 11:30 a.m. For more information, head to radiantbc.com/Easter. Our next child dedications is coming up on Sunday, April 21st during both services. During child dedications, we as parents acknowledge that children are a gift from God and that we need His wisdom to raise them. To learn more about child dedications, head to radiantbc.com/events today. Are you new to Radiant Church? Join us for our next New to Radiant on Sunday, April 7th at 1 p.m. New to Radiant is a 30-minute meeting where you'll get to meet our pastors, team leaders, and elders, as well as learn about next steps you can take here at the church. You can sign up today at radiantbc.com/new. For more information on Radiant Church, you can check us out online at radiantbc.com or join the conversation on social media at Radiant Bay City.
Good morning, Radiant Church. Good to see everyone this morning. Welcome everybody who this is your first or your second time. We're just so grateful that you're with us this morning. Anybody here this last Wednesday night? Oh, if you weren't here, you missed a great preach. I mean, Pastor Lee Cummings was here. He's the head of Radiant Network, and he talked about the importance of prayer. And he talked about how a praying church can change the city around them, how a praying church can change their whole region. It was a great message. That coming right on top of Pastor Marco's message from the weekend and before. I'm one of the elders here. I don't know if I told you. Did I tell you my name's Barry? Well, thanks. It's like I'm going to some kind of a meeting. Hi, Barry. We're glad you're here. On behalf of all the elders, our elders we're a team. Troy, Bill, and myself. We want you to know just how grateful we are to serve you under the leadership of Pastor Marco. I value Pastor Marco, not just because he's sitting over there, but because he's my pastor, and I value him because he's a great speaker, and I value him because he's a great leader. But most of all, yeah, you just gave me brownie points with Pastor Marco. but most of all, I want you to know I value Pastor Marco because he's a great friend. Every time Pastor Marco asks me, this is kind of a secret that's not so secret. Every time that Pastor Marco asks me to do something special for him, like this message, my head, my heart, my mind, it just all descends right into full-on crisis mode. I get the shakes, you know, and especially this last week. Now, come on. Last Sunday, Pastor Marco. Last Wednesday, Pastor Lee. Today, I feel like this was a setup. But at the same time, you know, I ask myself questions like, what am I going to talk about? And then I ask, doesn't Pastor Marco know that I'm an old retired guy? And old retired guys just like to tell a bunch of old stories. But at the same time, super interesting to people like me. I mean, I'm really interested in all my stories. But being in a crisis, it's always a crisis, isn't it? Whenever we're in crisis, it's always a crisis. There are a number of you here this morning who are in the middle of a crisis right now. And we want you to know that as your church family, that we're here for you. We want to listen. We want to pray with you. We want to do whatever we can to help you come out of this crisis. Statistics show that 4 in every 10 people will experience a significant financial crisis. Statistics show that 7 out of every 10 people will go through a major relational crisis. 7 out of 10. The chances of us experiencing a major job or career crisis are 1 in 10. 57% of all Americans report losing a very close loved one within the last 3 years. That's a crisis. The chances of us experiencing an extended emotional crisis like a depression are 2 in 10. Palm Sunday is what's known in Christian circles as the beginning of Holy Week. This is the week that we especially remember Jesus' suffering and death. This is the week we especially remember his sacrifice for our sins. And as much as Holy Week ends with Jesus' horrific death, I want you to know that it was a crisis for his disciples. It was a real crisis. Theirs was a crisis of faith. Theirs was a crisis of hope. Theirs was a crisis of fear. Theirs was a crisis of being all alone. Crises happen much more often than we realize. This morning, I want to share this selection with you from something that will sound really familiar. This is from the Elevation Gospel. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. O rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. You heard your children then. You hear your children now. You're the same God. You're the same God. You answered prayers back then. You will answer now. You're the same God. You're the same God. You freed captives then. You're freeing hearts right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. I'm calling on the Holy Spirit. Almighty River, come and fill us again. As I was thinking about the song this morning, as I was thinking about these words, I think this is a real prayer for us whenever we're in crisis. Holy Spirit, come and fill me again. Come and fill me again. Let's pray this prayer this morning. Come and fill me again. Come and fill me again. Lord, I just pray that you would be with all of those who are in crisis right now. Sometimes we go through small crises, sometimes through these huge, huge crises. I pray that you would be with us, that you'd watch over us, that you'd lead us, that you'd guide us, that you'd protect us, that your Holy Spirit would work in a mighty way in our lives. We dedicate this time to you, Jesus. We dedicate this time to you at the beginning of this Holy Week where we watch you go to the cross, pay for our sin. But we also need to remember that during this Holy Week, when it's Friday, when you're suffering and you're dying in our place, help us to remember that Sunday is coming. Sunday is coming when we will celebrate your great and glorious resurrection from the dead. To you be all praise and honor and glory in your mighty name, amen. If you have your Bible with you, I invite you to open it to the Gospel of John. We're going to be in the 11th chapter this morning. The Gospel of John, if you're new to the Bible, is the fourth book of the New Testament, right after Matthew, Mark, and Luke. If you don't have a Bible with you this morning, if you want to use a Bible, there's some in the cart at the back of the room. For me, it's always a paper Bible. I love my paper Bible. I mean, it's quick to go on an app and look at it, but I like holding it in my hands. I like the feel of it. I like it because I can write my notes in it. And I want to tell you, every time, every day, before I start my Bible study, I kiss my Bible. And I picture myself kissing the feet of Jesus. And when I'm done, I kiss it again, giving all the glory to God, because this is His Word, and His Word teaches us about Him. That's why we love it so much. So in John chapter 11, we're going to begin in verse 1. John chapter 11 is the famous account of raising Lazarus from the dead. Bible scholars believe that Jesus raised Lazarus about 6 weeks before his own death. So John chapter 11, verse 1. Now a man from named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When Jesus heard this, he said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it's for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Then he said to his disciples, "Let's go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you're going back?" And if you're following in your Bible, drop down to verse 13. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I'm glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Then Thomas, also known as Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." And then drop down to verse 21. Jesus goes to Bethany, and he meets Martha. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." In this passage of Scripture, we're going to have Thomas serve as our person of interest. We're going to have raising Lazarus from the dead as our anchor point, and we're going to have the word believe be the key to what we want to hear this morning. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul writes this, "Therefore, I want you to know that no one speaking by the Spirit of God says, 'Jesus be cursed,' and no one can say, 'Jesus is Lord,' except by the Holy Spirit." What this means is that the Holy Spirit is the one who gives us faith. The Holy Spirit gives us faith, and his faith has a name. His gift has a name. It's faith. Now, I am a DIY kind of guy. If I can fix something, I don't want to pay somebody to come over and fix it for me. I've been humiliated enough in my lifetime. One time, I could not figure out why the electricity in my bathroom wouldn't come on. And I tried everything. I'm out examining the box in the garage, and I couldn't figure it out. So I called an electrician. He came over and pushed a button on the GFI burner. So I'm a DIY kind of guy. And as a DIY kind of guy, I've got a lot of tools. I mean, I got a lot of tools. I got power. But just because I have a lot of tools doesn't mean that I know how to use them. The Holy Spirit, when he gives us power, what he does, he gives us his power, but the question is, when I find myself in crisis, when you find yourself in crisis, do we always know how to rely upon our faith? Do we always know how to use our faith? Sometimes out of fear, we don't even remember our faith. Look at John. I want us to look at John chapter 3, verse 16. This is one of the most famous verses in the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So the Holy Spirit gives us power. The Holy Spirit gives us faith to believe in Jesus so we can have eternal life. Now we're going to read the next couple of verses starting in John 17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. If we want to be a part of God's kingdom, God requires that we believe in him. He's always looking out for us, because if we don't believe, what we're going to end up with is the worst crisis of our entire lives. And that worst crisis is going to be the crisis of eternal life. So God's always looking out for us. I've heard it say, maybe you have too, that faith is the currency of heaven. Faith is to heaven what money is to earth. Faith is what God uses to transact business, to put it crassly. For example, in Genesis chapter 15, we read, Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. Because faith is the currency of heaven, God offered Abram an exchange. He took Abram's faith, and in exchange, he gave them his righteousness, God's righteousness. We see this also in John chapter 11 when Jesus says to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? So faith is God's exchange medium. In exchange for faith, God makes us a part of his kingdom and gives us eternal life. But if I take your faith away, you won't be a part of his kingdom. If I take your faith away, you won't have victory. If I take your faith away, you won't have peace. If I take your faith, you can't have real joy. If I take your faith, you won't have power. If I take your faith, you won't have conviction. If I take your faith, you won't have confidence. If I take your faith, you won't have boldness. The Bible wants us to understand that a lack of faith, think about this, a lack of faith is an insult to God. Why? Because God says, I am the way and the truth and the life. But if without faith, if we don't have faith, if we deny that, we're calling God a liar. So it's an insult to God. I'm telling you these things because on this Palm Sunday, this week that ends with Jesus on the cross, I want you to understand just how important faith is. Because if you don't understand the importance of faith, you'll never really understand that when you think you're in some kind of a crisis, like a financial crisis, when you think you're in a relational crisis, a health crisis, that's not true at all. You're really in a spiritual crisis. I've never known a crisis to come at a good time. Every crisis comes at the worst time. Every financial crisis hits when I've got more bills than paycheck. Every relational crisis feels us feeling vulnerable and alone. Every health crisis brings us down. Every time somebody in our life passes away, we're never really prepared for it. And when you lose your job, it's when you realize, I need that job. Trials, crises, they always seem to come when all hell is breaking loose. When we're uncertain and insecure and unprepared. And to make matters worse, this was when Satan rubs his hands together, looks at us and says, I see an opportunity. It's when Satan starts to play around in our lives, to fill our heads with lie after lie and after lie. And he paints all these nightmare scenarios so that we believe that things are going to end up the absolute worst way that they could ever possibly be. Palm Sunday began a week that ended in crisis. It was a real crisis for those who followed Jesus. But under all the chaos of this week was a faith crisis because of the men who were his disciples really believed in him. They believed in him, so they'd left their jobs. They believed in him, so they left their families. They believed in him, so they left everything that was familiar to them, and they followed him on foot for hundreds and hundreds of miles just because they believed in him. And they thought they understood him. They thought, Jesus is bringing the kingdom of God, which he was. But then they thought the Romans would be overthrown. We'll have them out of our lives. We'll have them out of our country. They thought that Jesus would be king over the whole earth and that they would sit on seats beside him with positions of power. But halfway through this process, Jesus started saying some strange things, things that made them stop and stare at each other. He said things like this, destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days. He said, truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Jesus started talking about death a lot. And that's when the disciples started asking each other questions. Why does he keep talking about dying? Jesus dying wasn't a part of their plan. It wasn't a part on their radar. They'd followed Jesus because they'd witnessed his power. They'd seen him walk on water. They'd seen him heal the sick, cast out demons. They'd seen him turn water into wine, make the lame walk, the blind see, the deaf hear. And on top of it all, they'd seen him raise Lazarus from the dead after Lazarus had been in the tomb 4 days. 4 days Lazarus had been in the grave. But then toward the end of this week, Jesus suddenly acted like he had no power. His enemies arrested him. Jesus did nothing. Sanhedrin tried him. Jesus said little. He was whipped and beaten after being turned over to the Romans. But he acted like a sheep. They nailed him to a cross, and through it all, Jesus acted completely powerless. So the disciples were suddenly in crisis. How do I go back and tell them that I followed someone who wasn't what I thought he was? I thought I'd seen him do miracles. How do I tell my wife that I'd followed someone who ended up dying like a common criminal? After Jesus' crucifixion, most of the disciples ran back to the upper room and hid because they said, if they killed my pastor, they'll kill me too. They all huddled together in fear. Most of them, but not all. Remember, Judas had committed suicide. And where was Peter? Hey, where is Peter? Or excuse me, Thomas. Can you tell I'm a little rusty? It's part of the crisis that I'm in right now. Remember courageous Thomas, the one who said, let us also go so we can die with him? We often refer to Thomas as doubting Thomas, but that's really not a good description of him. Thomas had courage, but right at that moment, his faith was in crisis. I've experienced some deep, deep crisis in my life. I don't know what caused it, what happened, but I went through a severe depression. It lasted 6 years. Every day was dark. I didn't think anybody cared about me, not even my family. I felt all alone, and I felt like God had absolutely abandoned me. But for all these crises that I've been through, none of it compares with the crisis that some of you are in right now. Because when you're in crisis, it's personal. It's deeply, deeply personal. No one ever really understands what you're going through. And every crisis brings us down. It's always on our minds. It's always right in front of us. We keep searching and searching for solutions, but we can't find the solutions. It's like we're in this fog. We've got this terrible weight upon our shoulders. Crisis is a terrible thing. It's a deeply hurtful thing to go through. But here's the truth behind every crisis. Behind every crisis is a real spiritual crisis. And when we're in crisis, we start to ask questions like, God, why did you allow this to happen to me? Lord, where were you when my mother died? Why didn't you save her? God, why do I have cancer and why now? Why can't you free me from this abusive relationship I'm in? I'm in the depths of depression. God, why can't you make it go away? God, I've got this addiction and I just can't get free of it. I've lost my job. How am I supposed to feed my kids? All these are spiritual questions because you're in the middle of a spiritual crisis. And the biggest question of all is, where are you, God? Why aren't you answering my prayers? The truth is, God is answering your prayers. Because as someone who believes in Jesus, he's right here with you. The thing about God, even if we realize it or not, he is always before us to lead us. He is always behind us to protect us. He's always above us to bless us, and he's all around us, all around us. God loves you so much that I want you to understand, he is your lover, he is your provider, he is your defender, and he is the one who gives you strength. And he will never, ever, never leave you alone. And what we don't realize so often is that God is right here inside of us. He's inside of us. So on Good Friday, Jesus never lost his power. He just chose not to use it. Go back to our anchor point, the raising of Lazarus from the dead. You probably heard this before, but do you know why Jesus specifically called Lazarus to come out of the grave? He called Lazarus because if he hadn't named Lazarus, every person who ever died would have come out of their graves. They'd have thought it was the last day. Jesus has so much power that he got up and walked away from his own grave. Our Savior King is alive, and he lives to use his power to get us through every crisis. And here's the thing about God. He comes right just when we need it the most. The 10 disciples were together in the upper room, scared and praying, when suddenly Jesus walked in the door, through the door, and he appeared among them. And the Bible says, and they were overjoyed. But Thomas wasn't there. Where's Thomas? Has anybody seen him? It was only later that Thomas decided to rejoin the other disciples in the upper room. He was there, but he really wasn't there. And that he heard all the disciples saying, Jesus was here, Jesus was here, but he didn't believe it. Because he was in crisis, Thomas said this, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. God will sometimes allow us to endure our crisis for a while because he's trying to teach us something. And what he's trying to teach us is the importance of our faith. So a week later, Jesus appeared again to rescue Thomas. And he said, Thomas, put your finger here. Put your hand into my side. And when they had finished their conversation, Jesus said this, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. So when you're facing a crisis of any kind, have faith, believe. Stop and remember that Jesus never leaves us alone, but is always with us just as he promised. This week is all about watching Jesus take up his cross and lay down his life for us. But be sure of this. Every precious drop of blood that Jesus shed, every precious drop of blood from the whip that scourged his back, every precious drop of blood shed from the crown of thorns that was pushed down on his head. Every precious drop of blood from the strike of the hammer as he was nailed to the cross. Every precious drop of blood that Jesus shed gives us a share in his victory. So if you're in crisis right now, don't doubt, don't think that God has somehow abandoned you. Don't doubt his love and start to wonder if he cares about you. Don't despair because you doubt whether he's heard your prayers. Believe in Jesus' power. Believe in his love. Believe that he'll give you peace in the middle of your worst crisis. Believe he's coming toward you to rescue you in the middle of the storm. Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed. Now, I wouldn't be doing the old retired guy's code of honor. I wouldn't be faithful to that code of honor unless I told you a story. So it's an old man story. It happened years and years and years and years ago. I was just a little kid. Not really. Then I went, when I was in the third year of seminary, where I attended, you got sent out into the field. It was like you would practice being a pastor under the direction of another pastor. So most of the guys got sent out, and they were in some large congregation, and they assisted the senior pastor, the lead pastor, and they got to bring coffee to meetings and take notes and things like that. But Judy and I, because of my teaching experience, we got sent to the southeast corner of Nebraska to a little town in the rolling hills called Pawnee City. Pawnee City, when I got sent there, this was in the 80s. I told you it was old. It got sent there in the 80s. It was like stepping back into the 1950s. So this town had 600 people, four churches, plus the one that I was sent to. Now, at the seminary I attended, in your third year, you weren't allowed to call yourself a pastor. But people have to call you something. So I was told that people were supposed to call me vicar. So my name's Barry. They thought my last name was Barry, and they thought my first name was Victor. So they would call me Victor Barry. Hey, here comes Victor Barry. So a few months after I got to this church, I got the elders together, and I said, who in this church, in this town, doesn't go to church? And they said, everybody in this town goes to church. Everybody goes to church. I said, there must be at least one person in this town who doesn't go to church. And they said, oh, yeah, there's Old Herman. I said, Old Herman? Yeah, he's an old guy. He's about 80, farmed a lot of land about 8 miles out of town. I said, well, give me some directions. How do I get to Herman's farm? They said, oh, no, he doesn't farm anymore. He lives in town, about 3 blocks away. I said, okay, guess I'm going to go see Herman. Now, evangelism is not one of my gifts. There are some people that are just fantastic with evangelism. I'm always kind of shaky, you know. So on the way, the 3 blocks going over to Herman's house, I kept saying these prayers, oh, Lord, help me. I need so much help. I don't know what I'm going to say. So I paced up and down in front of Herman's house for a few minutes till I finally worked up enough courage. I went up and knocked on the door. And I heard some noise inside, and it took about 3 minutes for him to get to the door. And he opened it, and he was about 6 inches taller than me, and he looked down on me, and he said, what do you want? I don't want anything. No. So I said, well, some friends of mine, I'm new in town, some friends of mine, I've just made them, told me that you'd be a good guy to get to be friends with.
Why?
I said, because you're a real interesting person. He thought about it for a while, finally opened the door and let me in. And this was just a little salt box kind of a house, and he had a hospital bed in the living room. What I didn't know, until later, was the doctors had told Herman he only had a few months to live. So we sat down in his living room, and we stared at each other for a while. And then I said, can you tell me something about yourself, Herman? And so he went on to describe how he had farmed these hundreds and hundreds of acres since 1950. And he had brought this guy over from Germany after World War II to help him. But he'd never been married, never had kids. And so now he didn't farm anymore because he physically couldn't. So he said, tell me about yourself. I said, my name's Victor Barry. And he said, what do you do? I said, well, I had explained third year seminary and so on at the church. Oh, yeah, I know that church. So we started to talk a little bit more, got to know each other. And then over the next 6 weeks, I came back to visit Herman 2-3 times a week. And as we got to know each other, and he got to know what I did, he said, tell me about Jesus. And so I brought a Bible, and I said, here, you can have this Bible. And we started to talk about Jesus and talk about what he'd done for us, his salvation he won for us on the cross, how Jesus got up from the dead. And Herman just listened the whole time. He didn't say much. And then finally, after about 6 weeks, he said to me, I think I believe in this Jesus guy. He said, and you know, I'm sorry for the way I've lived my life. And then he asked, can I be baptized? Now, as a third-year seminarian, I wasn't allowed to baptize anyone. So I got my supervising pastor, who lived 55 miles away, to come over to our little church, and Herman was baptized. And this is what I'll never forget this. This is what he said when he came up out of waters of baptism. He got this big smile on his face, and he said, now I belong to Jesus. About 3 months later, Herman avoided the worst crisis of his life. He passed away, and he's with Jesus now, and Jesus has given him the victory. So when we're in crisis, I don't want you to be afraid. God is not afraid of our uncertainty. God is not afraid of our doubts. God is not afraid that we don't always remember to pray when we should. But when we go to God in prayer, when we go to him and say, Lord, I need you now, he always answers that prayer. It may not take away the problem for us, but he'll give us the peace that passes all understanding. And he will give us the right people at the right time to be in our lives. If you're in the middle of a crisis today, our prayer team is going to come up here. Just come up. We invite you to come forward. Our prayer team, we just love to pray with people. Everything that you say will be kept confidential, but come up for prayer. And if you're in a crisis right now, and if you're not in a crisis, you know one's coming sometime. I want to pray for all of us now. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for the victory that you won for us on the cross. Thank you for your resurrection that promises that we too will rise and be with you forever. We want to thank you that you have been with us this morning, your Holy Spirit with us. And I just pray that this message, as rusty and as shaky as it seemed to me, I just pray that this message would take root in the heart of those who are going through crisis right now. For you never leave us, Lord. You never abandon us. You never stop hearing our prayers. You are always with us. You are always our lover, our provider, our defender, and the one who gives us strength. So we proclaim Jesus. We proclaim you as our Lord, our God, our King, and we lay all of our problems, all of our troubles at your feet. Sometimes when we're in crisis, I want to remind everybody here that just picture in your minds that you're taking all your problems, all your worries, all your cares, all your anxiety, the weight of unanswered questions, and you're putting them in a box. And before you is standing Jesus, and Jesus holds out his hands, and you give him that box. And in return, he gives you victory and the peace that passes all understanding, knowing that he is always with you, defending you, and blessing you, and he lives inside of you. We could pray all honor and praise and glory to you, King Jesus, in your mighty name. Amen. Have a great week, everybody.